नमस्कार फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ फिजिक्स माय 13th टॉक द टॉपिक इज काइनेमैटिक्स इन टू डायमेंशंस पार्ट 1 प्रोजेक्टाइल मोशन. सो फार वी हैव डिस्कस्ड कार्टेशियन स्पेस इन वन डायमेंशनल एंड टू डायमेंशनल मैनर, काइनेमैटिक्स इन वन डायमेंशन वेयर वी हैव डिफाइंड अ सेट ऑफ काइनेमैटिक क्वांटिटीज स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम द पोजीशन वेक्टर, वेलोसिटी, एक्सेलरेशन, jerk, snap, crackle and pop, and we have discussed certain cases in one dimensions and specifically the case of uniform motion, uniform acceleration. And in the last two talk we learned vector algebra and how the generalization of one dimensional vectors which we introduced initially can help us in developing kinematics for two dimensions and three dimensional will be obvious now in these lectures which I am presenting. So kinematic quantities in two dimensions as discussed in last talk can be defined in the same manner as we have defined kinematics quantities in one dimension but by generalizing to two dimensions. So the position vector, which is the function of time for any particle in two dimension, will be given by the position vector r vector denoted by r vector is equal to x I cap plus y j cap, where x and y are said to be projection of the position vector on x and y axis respectively, or you can call x and y are component of the position vector along x and y axis respectively, or here for the case of position vector this can also be meaning that these are coordinates of the point of location of the particle in two dimensional space, xy space. So x is the x coordinate and y is the y coordinate. So we can discuss the vector expressions as well as the components, x component and y component. And as discussed earlier, given the position vector you can obtain the velocity vector by the method of differentiation, and the velocity vector would also be expressed in terms of components or projections. So vx here denotes the x component of the velocity vector, vy denotes the y component of the velocity vector, and v vector is the velocity of the particle. So the x component or projection of velocity vector along x axis vx will be given by dx by dt, and vy will be given by dy by dt. Similarly, we can define acceleration as the rate of change of velocity with respect to time, and therefore the acceleration vector A can also be decomposed into components like AXI plus AYJ. AX is the X component of acceleration, which is equal to the rate of change of VX with respect to time, or the second rate of change of X with respect to time, or you can call the first differential coefficient or first derivative of vx with respect to time, or second differential coefficient or second derivative of x with respect to time. And similarly we define ay as dvy by dt or d square y by dt square. So from position vector, if it is given as a function of time, you can obtain by differentiation velocity vector, and you can obtain by differentiation acceleration vector. Since we are choosing Cartesian space and the x and y axis are mutually perpendicular to each other and independent of each other, so the base vector I and j do not depend upon each other, so you can solve problem either by using vector expression or by using the component expression for each component, x component as well as y component. The other situation is that instead of given position, if acceleration is given, if you know the acceleration as a function of time, you can obtain the velocity by integrating the acceleration with respect to time, and you can obtain the position vector as a function of time by integrating the velocity. And as pointed out earlier, in case of integration, the constant of integration will be involved. So in all there are three quantities: position vector, velocity vector and acceleration vector. But since each of this quantity has two components, so there are six quantities in that manner: the x coordinate, y coordinate, vx, vy and ax and ay, and the time is also a parameter, so you can plot several two-dimensional graphs by using any two variables. For example, you can plot y versus x, you can plot x versus time, y versus time, vx versus time, vy versus time, or vy versus vx, or ax versus ay, or ax versus time, or ay versus time. So in that manner, the graphically we can express the relationship between these quantities, which are kinematic quantities in two dimensions. Now I consider the case of uniform motion in case of two dimension. We are generalizing what we have learned in one dimension. The uniform motion in one dimension we have defined as a case of the motion where the velocity is constant, and therefore all higher derivatives like acceleration, jerk, snap, etc. will be zero. So uniform motion was defined by the term acceleration equals to zero and velocity equals to constant in one dimension. The same is applied here. So uniform motion in two dimension means velocity is constant and acceleration equals to zero. Since acceleration is zero, it automatically means that x component of the acceleration is zero, as well as the y component of the acceleration, that is also zero. Velocity is constant, and let me choose that the constant value of the x component is ux and the constant value of the y component is uy. So ux and uy represents the velocity which is constant throughout the motion, and you can also call this velocity would also be the velocity at time t equal to 0, and it is at all time. So this is being denoted by ux and uy respectively. So the velocity vector is given by vxi plus vyj, or you can write uxi plus uyj. Similarly, position vector can be obtained by integrating the velocity vector. Since the velocity is constant, so the position vector x will be given by uxt plus x0, and y will be given by uyt plus y0, and this can be x0 understood in this manner, that x0 is the constant of integration, which is the value of the x coordinate at time t equals to 0, and similarly y0 is the value of y coordinate at t equals to 0. So we can understand the uniform motion in the same manner, and then we can interpret how the curves would look like. Acceleration, whether you plot ax versus time or ay versus time, the curve will be the time axis itself, because acceleration is 0. Vxt curve will be a line parallel to time axis with intercept ux on vx axis, because vxt curve it will represent constant value ux for all instant of time. So it will be a line parallel to the time axis and cutting the vx axis at the intercept ux, and similarly vyt will be a line parallel to time axis and it will be cutting the vy axis at uy. But the xt curve and yt curve, as obvious from this formula which is given here, x equals to uxt plus x0 and y equals to uyt plus y0, xt curve will be a straight line with the slope ux and intercept x0. Yt curve would be a straight line with the slope uy and intercept y0. And from this relations, if you eliminate the t, then you can get the expression between y and x. And the expression between y and x is called the expression of trajectory. And so you can prove that in this case of uniform motion, y equals to y0 plus uy by ux whole times x minus x0. And this is a straight line, and this straight line is having a slope of uy divided by ux and an intercept which is given here, y0 minus uy by divided by ux times x0. So this is the intercept and this is the slope of the yx curve, and yx curve would also be a straight line. So initially we have considered one dimension, in that case such a curve was not possible. Now we have two spatial dimensions, so we can understand the trajectory in terms of the plot of yx curve. Uniform acceleration is the next example which we wish to generalize for two dimension. Uniform acceleration means acceleration is not equal to zero, it's a non-zero constant. If acceleration is zero and constant, that would be considered as uniform motion, explained already. And so uniform acceleration means acceleration equals to constant, and instead of introducing new symbol, I am denoting ax as a constant uniform x component of acceleration and ay as a constant uniform acceleration y component. So vector a is a constant vector. Now you integrate in vector expression, then you get the velocity by integration of acceleration dt. Since acceleration is constant, integration of dt is t, so you get v velocity vector is equals to acceleration time times plus constant of integration, which you can evaluate to be equal to the initial velocity u, which is the velocity at time t equals to 0, because when you put time t equals to 0, the velocity is equals to that constant of integration. So we get the relationship v equals to u plus at, and now we can differentiate the position. To obtain the position, we can integrate the velocity vector and obtain the position, and therefore the position vector r is by definition integration of v dt, and so we substitute for v, which is u plus at, and the integration of u dt will give you ut, the integration of at dt t dt will give you t square by 2, so you have half at square. Remember, u is the initial velocity, so it's a fixed number, and acceleration is constant. So these are constant and do not depend upon time, and so integration of dt is t, and integration of t dt is t square by 2. Constant of integration can be evaluated in the same manner as discussed earlier, and it would be the position vector at instant t equals to 0 being denoted by r0. You can also understand it in terms of x component and y component. So in case of x component, what we get, that we can get the vx component, the velocity of the velocity, the x component of the velocity, by integrating the x component of acceleration, and we get here the x component of velocity is equals to the x component of the initial velocity plus axt. And similarly, we get for y that vy is equal to uy, the x component of the initial, y component of the initial velocity plus ayt. And we can also do the same thing for the obtaining the x and y coordinate or the x and y component of the position vector. And you can show that by integrating vx dt, we can prove that x equals to x0 plus uxt plus half axt square, and y equals to y0 plus uyt plus half ayt square, where y0 is the y coordinate at t equals to 0, x0 is the x coordinate at t equals to 0, ux is the initial velocity x component at t equals to 0, and uy is the initial velocity y component at t equals to 0. And the acceleration ax and ay are constant, time is a variable, so we now have a relationship, and we have derived the equations, which are also called Newton's equation, and we can write this Newton's equation for motion for uniform acceleration in two dimension in the same manner as discussed earlier. In case of one dimension, the five equation can be written, which I have written here. As vector is defined as the displacement in time interval t equals to 0 to t equals to t, and that is by definition equals to r minus r0. So the first equation, vector equation, is the velocity vector is equals to the initial velocity vector plus acceleration vector times t. The second equation is the displacement vector is equals to the initial velocity vector times t plus half acceleration vector times t square. And the other relations can be derived by using these two equations. You can prove that v dot v, you can take the dot product of this with itself, and v dot v, dot product we have already defined, is u dot u plus 2 acceleration dot the displacement vector. And by another method, you can also eliminate, you can find the value of u from this expression and substitute here, and show that the displacement vector can also be written as the final velocity at any instant t times t minus half acceleration vector times t square. So we have this expression of the displacement vector involving the initial velocity, this vector expression which involves the velocity at any instant t, and we can add these two expression, and then we can get 2s equals to u plus v. So we get s equals to u plus v t times by 2. So 2s we will get u plus v times t, the u plus v whole times t. So as clear from this picture shown to you. So we can express the five equations in terms of the vector form, and we can also express this equation in component form, as we can separate out the x component and y component as explained earlier. Because x and y axes are mutually independent to each other, the forms are quite similar. The advantage with the component form is that component form is a scalar form and therefore easy to handle mathematically. And whereas the vector form is a compact form, and it is always advisable to use compact form, and then you can make out the scalar component form from this very easily. Now you can understand that in case of uniform acceleration, the axt, the x component of acceleration or time, or y component of acceleration and time curve would be a line parallel to the time axis, because these are constants. And vxt curve would be a straight line, and it would be having a slope equal to the acceleration component, which means vxt curve will be a straight line with slope acceleration's x component, and the intercept equals to the x component of the initial velocity. And similarly, vy time curve would be a straight line with the slope equal to the y component of acceleration and intercept equal to the initial velocity y component. Xt curve is a parabola, because it involves, as you know, the r or x is equals to, from this relationship we know that x equals to x0 plus ut plus half at t square type form, and which means that it involves the t square. So xt curve would be a parabola, so will be a yt curve, and so would be, even if you eliminate the t, then so would be a curve between x and y. So we find that whether you plot xt curve or yt curve or xy curve, these curves would be parabola in case of uniform acceleration in two dimension. Now we discuss the specific example of projectile motion. Projectile motion is a form of motion experienced by a launched object such as a ball or an arrow or a cannon or a missile or any object which you wish to include, but would be referred here as projectile. So, projectile motion is a form of motion experienced by a projectile. Projectile motion can be regarded, and we will regard it as a motion with uniform acceleration, and that acceleration is arising due to gravity of earth, and we will ignore all other effects like the buoyancy, viscous force due to air, effect of wind flow, effect of non-inertial frames, GTR corrections, variation of acceleration due to gravity of earth with altitude, and other things. So we just assume that motion is occurring, the projectile motion is occurring under the influence of an acceleration which is directed vertically downward, and which in magnitude is equal to the g, the acceleration due to gravity, which has a value of 9.8 meter per second square, which we take as a standard value, and which can be approximated to 10 meter per second square if we wish for simple numerical estimates. So first we consider the projectile which is launched from the ground. So from the ground, if I am launching a projectile from the ground, I am projecting it, then in that case how to be? Let the point from which it is launched will choose as origin, and let u be the projection speed, and let the angle, the velocity, projection velocity is making with the horizontal, be theta. So here I have chosen three things: that the projectile is being launched from the origin, it is being launched with the projection speed u, and it is being launched at the angle theta to the horizontal. In this case, in whichever horizontal direction you launch the projectile, because the acceleration due to gravity is causing the change in the state of motion, the path of the projectile will remain confined to a vertical plane, and that vertical plane will have vertical direction and one of the horizontal direction. In case of horizontal direction, as discussed earlier, there are infinite directions, and suppose we choose east as an x-axis and north as the y-axis, then we have understood those infinite direction in the earlier discussion of vector algebra. But what we are doing here, that we are choosing the y-axis along the vertical upward direction. So the acceleration would be directed towards the minus j unit vector, which means the j is the unit vector along the y-axis, and minus j would be indicating vertical downward direction. So we choose vertical upward direction as positive y-axis, and the x-axis would be chosen in the plane, because the vector, the projection velocity and the acceleration vector, they will make a plane. In that plane, whatever the horizontal direction is involved, that direction will be taken, along that direction we will be choosing the x-axis,
But the sense of the direction would be so chosen that the you can say that the y-axis is at a 90 degree angle anticlockwise from the x-axis, or you can say the x-axis is at the angle minus 90 degree or minus pi by 2 radian to the y-axis. The x-axis is at minus 90 degree angle to the y-axis. In this manner, we will be choosing the directions. Now, after making a choice of the frame of reference, the origin at the point of launch, the vertical upward direction as the y-axis, and a horizontal direction appropriately chosen as the x-axis, and we determine that the projection as velocity is making an angle theta and its speed is u. Projection speed means the magnitude of the velocity is u, and therefore you can write that the initial conditions are such that the position vector at time t equal to 0 is 0 because the projectile is being launched from the origin, and initial velocity u can be decomposed in vector form as u cosine theta I plus u sine theta j as explained in the vector algebra. Because it is making an angle theta with the x-axis and its magnitude is u, it can be written as u cos theta I plus u sine theta j, and which means the x component of the initial velocity is u cos theta, y component of the initial velocity is u sin theta, and acceleration, because it is acting vertically downward, would be written as minus g times the j cap, the unit vector along the y axis. And as pointed out earlier also, that we will be using the value of g equal to 9.8 meter per second square as a standard value, but for numerical estimate you can also make use of 10 meter per second square if you so wish. Now this is the situation. The projectile, this is the projection velocity which is making an angle theta with the x-axis. This is the x-axis chosen, this is the y-axis chosen, and in the xy plane it will have a trajectory. So projectile is being launched with at an angle theta, and so the initial velocity is u cos theta I plus u sin theta g. And now we discuss the problem by same method, the method of integration, that acceleration is given, and by integrating the acceleration we can have the velocity. And so acceleration is given as minus g times j, and we integrate it and we get that the velocity, since minus g, g is constant, and dt, the unit vectors are also constant. So you get here that this expression will give you that minus gt. So here t is missing, there is a typo, t is missing here. Remember, make a correction here, t is missing. So v equals to u minus gt j. And you can write this as, because you can write u explicitly, so u cos theta I plus u sin theta minus gt j, it has been corrected here. And now by integrating the velocity, similarly here t is missing, which you have to substitute, and you can get the r, the integration of the velocity will give you the r, the position vector, and you can show that the position vector is equal to the integration of u minus gtj dt, and u minus gtj dt will give you ut minus half gt square j. And if you express the component form, and if you expand the u in terms of u cos theta I plus u sin theta j, the final position vector can be written in this manner. The r vector is equals to u cos theta times t I plus u sin theta times t minus r dt square whole times j. So that is what we have obtained by integration, and that is called solving the problem. So you can solve the problem by method of integration. You can understand it also in terms of x component and y component separately. Integrating the x component of acceleration, you get ax equals to 0. Again here is a, because it is 0, x component is not there, there is no I, but Ay equals to minus g. So when you integrate, you get Vx equals to u cos theta. Here when you integrate, you get Vy equals to u sin theta minus gt. And if you integrate this further, then you get x and you get u cos theta t, where we have used the fact that at the time t equal to 0, it has been launched from the origin. And y equals to u sin theta t minus r gt square. Now from this expression of x, you can get time t equals to x divided by u cos theta. If you substitute time t equal to x divided by u cos theta, then you get this relation, which is a relation not involving time, and which is a relationship between y and x,
and such a relation is therefore called the equation of trajectory. And that is very obvious now from the given expression that the trajectory will be a parabola. And now to explore the problem further, we use the same approach as we did earlier in case of one dimension, and that the initially the velocity is having the two component, x component as well as a vertical upward component, y component. But the acceleration due to gravity is acting vertically downward. So acceleration due to gravity is acting vertically downward. In that situation, the acceleration due to gravity is since acting vertically downward. Therefore, the initial y component of the velocity which was there will decrease, and it will keep on decreasing till it becomes zero, and at that instant it will be at the maximum height. So the maximum height being denoted by hm will be attained at time denoted by tm. So tm denotes the time at which it attains the maximum height, and hm is the maximum height. So why it is not moving further high? Because at tm the velocity has become zero, y component of the velocity, not the x component of the velocity. Since there is no acceleration, the x component of the velocity, as learned from the previous calculation, will remain constant throughout the motion. So x component of the velocity would remain u cos theta throughout the motion, but the y component of the velocity becomes zero at instant t equals to tm. The expression for y component vy was u sin theta minus gt. So I substitute t by tm, and I get u sin theta minus gtm must be 0, and therefore I have the expression that the time taken in attaining maximum height is given by u sin theta by g. And to obtain the hm, I have to substitute this value of time in the expression of y. The expression of y was u sin theta t minus half gt square. I replace t by tm, so I get u sin theta tm minus half gtm square, and I replace tm by u sin theta by g, and do the simple mathematical calculation. This is u square sin square theta by g minus half u square sin square theta by g, so I get u square sin square theta by 2g. And so that is the value expression for hm I have derived, the expression for tm I have derived. The further that after getting the maximum height, it will, after going to the maximum height, it will come down again, because the acceleration would give or impart it a velocity in the negative y direction. So it would move vertically downward again, and it would hit the ground, not at the origin, but at some place away from the origin. It will hit the ground and it will move in the horizontal direction, in the directions of the projection velocity horizontal component, because it is having constant horizontal velocity. Very quite easy to understand. But we know that the time of flight is the time we are defining when it is just hit the ground. And when it will hit the ground, the y component of the at that particular instant will become zero. So if we denote tf as the time of flight, then at t equals to tf, y component is zero. The expression of t y component we already know, of coordinate u sin theta t minus half gt square, so I replace t by tf, so I get u sin theta tf minus half gtf square is equals to y at t equals to tf, and this must be 0. So one solution is tf equals to 0, which just tells you that it was at origin, or x y was 0 at instant t equals to 0. And the another component, which a solution which you get, is 2u sin theta by g, which is the expression for time of flight, and which you find, since u sin theta by g was the expression of time taken in attaining maximum height, we find that the time of flight is 2 times the time taken in attaining the maximum height. And the time of flight consists of two journey when the height is increasing, and the journey when height is decreasing. And we find that in this manner, the time of ascent, which is equals to tm, is same. Also time of descent is also equal to tm, and tf is equals to, you can say, twice the time of ascent and twice the time of descent. But remember, this is true for the special case which we are considering here, the projectile motion, when a projectile is launched from the ground. And now we can find the horizontal range. The maximum height is called vertical range of the projectile, and the word range in general would mean the horizontal range. And since the particle would fall at a certain distance away from the point of the launch in the horizontal plane or on the ground,
So the distance where it hits the ground from the point of origin measured along the horizontal direction is called the range or horizontal range. And horizontal range, since x is given by u cos theta t, I can replace the t by tf. So range is equals to u cos theta times tf. And therefore, this is equals to u cos theta into 2u sin theta by g. So you can write u square 2 sin theta cos theta g. But 2 sin theta cos theta is sine of 2 theta in trigonometry. This is an identity that 2 sin theta cos theta is equals to sine of 2 theta. So you should remember it. And therefore, the range is given by u square sin 2 theta by g. And similarly, we can obtain the expression for the velocity vf when it hits the ground. And the velocity when it hits the ground will be given by vf. You have to replace t by tf and u cos theta I, because x component remains constant, but the y component is u sin theta minus gtf. When you substitute the value of tf, which is 2u sin theta by g, you get u cos theta I minus u sin theta g. Remember, throughout the motion, the x component of the velocity remains constant. And this has been now depicted here, that when you launch a projectile from the ground and assuming that there are no other effects other than the gravity is involved, then what is happening, that the x component at the time of launch is u cos theta, y component at the time of launch is u sin theta. But when it hits the ground, the x component remains same, but the y component has reversed the sign and it is now u sin theta directed vertically downward. At the maximum height, the velocity, magnitude of the velocity, which we call speed, the speed is minimum and that is equal to the x component of the projection velocity or u cos theta. That is the minimum value. At all other places, the value of the speed will be more than that. In this diagram, the trajectory is shown. The trajectory is that of parabola. This is the point of vertex, and you can find from that kind of analysis also the expression of the maximum height, which we have shown earlier, that time taken, which means the time taken in completing this journey from this point to this point, will be u sin theta by g, and the maximum height hm will be u square sin square theta by 2g, and then another tm it will take to come down, and so tf is equals to 2u sin theta by g, and this horizontal distance, the distance between the point of launch and the point where it hit the ground, is equal to range or is equals to u square sin 2 theta by g. So that has been explained. You can remember this formula or expression of tn, hn, tf and u, because for solving numerical questions, sometimes if you know the expression, then you can do calculation directly by using the expression. Now in this picture, I am showing certain observations about the projectile or graph, yx graph for the projectile. When the speed has been chosen as 10 meter per second, I have used the value of g as 9.8 meter per second square, and what I find that for three different projection angles, so u is same but the projection angles are different, and therefore what you find that for this color, the projection angle, the green color, the projection angle is pi by 3, for this pi by 6, for this red pi by 4. And what I find that the range is more for pi by 4 and the range is same for pi by 6 and pi by 3. Now since you know the expression of the range is involving sine of 2 theta, and sine 2 theta would attain the maximum value 1 when 2 theta is 90 degree. And therefore, theta equal to 45 degree or pi by 4, in case of this kind of motion, when a projectile is launched from the ground at theta equal to 45 degree or pi by 4 radial, the range would be maximum. In this case evaluated, it is 10.17 after doing calculation. So, I have plotted this graph using Excel, the Microsoft Excel program. Now, the another point is that the range is maximum for pi by 4, but the range is same for 60 degree and 30 degree, or pi by 6 radian and pi by 3 radian. Why? Because sine of 60 degree is different than sine of 30 degree, but 60 degree to 2 theta is sine 120 degree, and 30 degree is also 2 times 2 theta is 60 degree, and you find that the sine of 120 degree is equals to sine of 60 degree, and so we say that for these two angles the 2 theta is such that sine of 2 theta is same value, and therefore the range would be same. In general, because we know that sine of theta is equals to sine of pi minus theta, so we get this particular relationship, and we can say that the horizontal range will be maximum for theta equal to 45 degree. The vertical range would be maximum because it involves u square sine square theta by g, so that kind of expression it involves. So what you find that the horizontal range would vertical range, the expression is was derived earlier. So the vertical range expression I have shown you, this is the expression u square sine square theta upon 2g. So it involves sine square theta, and sine theta is 1 when theta equals to 90 degree, or in this case, so there is a mistake, the vertical range will be maximum, 9 is missing here, substitute here, theta equals to 90 degree, please make a correction, theta equals to 90 degree, the vertical range will be maximum and the horizontal range will be maximum for theta equal to 45 degree. Angle theta and pi by 2 minus theta will have same range, horizontal range, and that is why the theta when you choose as pi by 6, then pi by 2 minus pi by 6 is pi by 3, or if theta you choose pi by 3, then pi by 2 minus theta is pi by 6, and these are having the same range, and now the projection angles are different. The projectile will definitely have minimum speed when it is at maximum height, and if you shoot an arrow into the air and you can do and observe it, then you find that the direction of the arrow, the changes during the parabolic flight path or to the ground, and it is always along the tangent to the parabolic path. So that is an interesting observation which you can make, and why it happens, it will be explained later in the series at appropriate stage. But this is an interesting thing which you can observe, that if an arrow is shot into the air as it follows the parabolic flight path to the ground, one finds that the arrow turns in flight so that it is always tangent to its flight path. Now we consider the another variation of the problem, that the projectile is not launched from the origin, but it is being launched from certain height h with some angle theta and the projection speed u, and so the projection velocity given by the same expression u cos theta I plus u sin theta j, but we have changed that the initial at time t equal to 0 the location was at height h, and we choose this point, the foot of perpendicular from the point of launch on the ground as the origin. So with this new definition that we have chosen the origin at just foot of the perpendicular from the point of launch, the point of launch is at hj, and the theta is the projection angle or velocity, projection velocity angle, u is the projection speed, and therefore the initial velocity or projection velocity is u cos theta I plus u sin theta j. The problem remains same under the acceleration due to gravity. So acceleration will be given by, acceleration is given by minus gj, where we have chosen the y axis in the vertical upward direction, and minus j indicate vertical downward direction, and we have chosen the x axis in the horizontal plane in which the projectile motion is taking place. There are infinite directions in the horizontal directions or horizontal plane, but we will choose the horizontal direction in which the projection velocity is having the component, you can say, and therefore the motion would take place in a vertical plane involving the horizontal direction indicated by the initial projection velocity as well as the vertical direction, and the vectors, initial velocity vector and the acceleration vector, which is acceleration is constant throughout the problem, forms a plane, and that plane the motion is taking place, and we have chosen the y axis and x axis in that particular plane. And remember, that we have taken g as 9.8 meter per second square for numerical calculation, and for estimate you can make 10 meter per second square as the value. So I repeat, we can solve again the problem. There are only few differences, so we would do that, and we will find that the velocity is given by u cos theta I plus u sin theta minus gt j. So this expression of velocity is same as previous explanation. The acceleration vx is u cos theta, vy is u sin theta minus gt. There is no difference in these expressions, but the expression of position vector would be different, because at r, at t equals to 0, r is not 0 but r is h. So we get the r vector as equal to ut cos theta I plus h plus ut sin theta minus r dt square j. So this factor of h has been added here. Otherwise you can compare it with the previous case, because we have not changed the initial velocity. So the expression of velocity or its component are same, but the expression of position vectors are different, in the sense that now the y component of the position vector, not the x component, but y component would have this term h, because initially it was at height h. So the y coordinate is given by h plus ut sin theta minus r gt square. So if I take t equal to x divided by u cos theta, substitute here, I would get the equation of trajectory, but this trajectory has the difference with the previous trajectory only of this term h. So previously we have, in case of projectile launched from the ground, you put h equals to 0 here, you will get that expression, the previous expression which we have used. In all this expression, the previous expressions can be obtained by putting h equals to 0 wherever it is appearing, and you find h is appearing here and here and in this 3 formula only out of the expression shown here. So these things are very important. Now we do the calculation. It would keep on attaining maximum height initially, because the velocity is having vertical upward component initially, and the acceleration is pointing vertically downward. So the vertical component of velocity would decrease due to the acceleration, and it will keep on decreasing till it becomes zero. It will become zero at the instant when we call time taken in attaining maximum height, and at that instant it will be at maximum height. By solving, since the expression is same, so we get the same formula for Tn, u sin theta by g, but the expression of y is different, and therefore we get the maximum height would be h plus u square sin square. This h maximum height would be more than h, so this would be h plus u square sin square theta divided by 2g, and correctly written, it would be highest for when the sin theta is sin 90 degree, theta is 90 degree, sin square theta will have maximum value. Time of flight can similarly be determined by putting y at t equals to tf equals to 0. This is the expression of y. I have replaced t by tf, so it reads h plus utf sin theta minus half gtf square equals to 0, but it is a quadratic equation. As discussed earlier, you can solve this quadratic equation and find the roots. There will be two roots. The root with negative sign here has been dropped, because that will give you the negative value of tf, and since the projectile was launched at t equals to 0, we are not interested in such unreliable solution. So the only viable solution is tf equals to u sin theta plus under the square root the quantity u square sin square theta plus 2gh whole, and we divided by whole divided by g. So we find that the time of flight is given by this expression, and which will be definitely more than the time of flight on the previous expression, which was 2u sin theta by g, because there is an additional term here, 2gh under the square root, and this gives you u sin theta by g. If h becomes 0, this would also give u sin theta by g, and it will become 2u sin theta by g. U sin theta by g is time taken in attaining maximum height, is time of ascent, and if you take under the square root u square sin square theta by 2gh upon g, that is time of descent, and you find that in this problem time of ascent and time of descent will be different. So that is not a general case, that you can't say that time of ascent is equal to time of descent. It will take more time in coming down than the moving up, as because it was initially at some height h, and when it falls on the ground, it has to fall also through that particular height h. And we can then obtain the expression of the horizontal range also by using the value of tf in the expression of the position x coordinate. So So the range is equals to x is equal to t equals to tf and is given by u cos theta tf. Since tf is a lengthy formula, so I have not replaced here tf, but you can remember by replacing it also. And so we have the range given by u cos theta tf. Everything is shown in coincide manner in this picture, that the particle is projected from height h at an angle theta, and the initial velocity is given here. This is the equation of trajectory given here. Acceleration is minus gj. Initially it was projected at t equals to 0 from h j. The maximum height attained is equal to this thing. This maximum height will be attained at the time taken at attaining maximum height. This is the expression for time of flight, and this is the expression for range. So in this diagram, if you just keep a copy of it, the entire information for projectile launched from height h, you can get the summary of that. But we can again do the calculation for three different angles. And here what I find, that in the previous case I have said, when the projectile is launched from the ground, that the horizontal range would be maximum for 45 degree. Here what you are finding, that I have taken a typical case where the initial projection speed is 10 meter per second and the height from which I am projecting is 5 meter, g is 9.8 meter per second square. And what I find for this typical case is that range is greater than for 30 degree and it is greater than range for 45 degree, and which is also greater than the range for 60 degree. So I mean to say, range for 30 degree is greater than range for 45 degree is greater than range for 60 degree. So don't memorize conclusions like that range is maximum for 45 degree. Range is definitely maximum for 45 degree in the specific case of projectile when launched from the ground. When it is launched from a height h, then the mathematical relation, and depending upon the cases chosen, the behavior may be different. And as we find in this particular typical example, the ranges are given and shown, and the path is shown with different color. For the angle, this is for 60 degree, this curve is for 30 degree, and which is in higher range, and this curve, red curve, is for 45 degree. So quite obvious from this graph you can read, each of the curve is a parabola, but these are parabola with a different shape, the parabolic shape. And you have already, I hope, learned how to describe and express the parabola, and how to find vertex of a parabola, how to express the parabola in vertex form or intercept form, and derive those quantities. I am not discussing that detail here now, because once you have learned, you can make use of it in understanding the projectile motion when a projectile launched from height h at a particular angle theta with a particular speed u, and the angle at which I am using is the angle measured with respect to the horizontal direction. Now we consider another special case, that now we project from height h, but we project it horizontally, which means it is not making any angle with the horizontal direction. So there are certain cases, for example, an object which rolls down a table and falls, then this kind of motion you can observe. And so the initial velocity u is only having x component and uy, acceleration is having y component. Initially there is no y component of the velocity, but because of the acceleration, it will get the velocity in vertical downward direction, the y component. So that we will get by solving the problem. We choose in the same manner the foot of the perpendicular to be the origin. This will be called the range, maximum height. So initially the r at t equals to 0 is hj as given here. The velocity u is given by ui. Theta is 0 in a sense, and acceleration is minus gj, and you can use the same set of value of 9.8 meter per second square for g as a standard value, or for numerical estimate 10 meter per second square. So this is the case which I am referring as horizontal projection from height h. And in case of horizontal projection from height h, though you have fired, for example, a bullet horizontally, it would get deviated and would fall down and may hit below the target, because bullets have high speed, so maybe the fall in the bullets would be comparatively less, and that we will understand when we will solve the numerical problem, the numerical estimates. But this is the motion of a bullet. When a bullet is fired horizontally, then it would get affected by the acceleration due to gravity. And especially if you are considering a long range of that target is at long distance, then the deviation in the vertical direction cannot be ignored. And we do the calculation in the same manner as did earlier. Acceleration is minus gj, so this gives me the velocity as u minus ui minus gtj. So minus gtj arriving from the integration of a, and this is due to the constant of integration. And I solve the problem for position. Once I have ui minus gtj, I integrate it with respect to time and I get the position vector. So the same approach, write down the acceleration, obtain the velocity by integrating it with respect to time, obtain the velocity expression, and then to obtain the position vector, again integrate the velocity expression with respect to time, and we get this relationship. And if you feel too comfortable only with the scalar component, first divide the what is the scalar x component and y component. The x component is 0 here, y component of acceleration is minus g, and so you get the velocity vx as u and vy as minus gt, and you get x as ut and y as h minus rgt square. So these scalar expressions are also useful in making understanding of it. From here I get t equals to x by u, I substitute here and get the equation of trajectory. It is very easy from this expression because it is falling in the, it is projected from the horizontal direction, it would keep on falling only, so there is no further height gain. So initially at time t equal to 0, it was at the maximum height. So time taken in attaining maximum height, you can say 0, and the maximum height is equal to the height at from which it has been launched. So that is very easy to understand. Now to understand time of flight, you have to put similarly to the previous example that y at t equals to tf is equals to 0. The y coordinate becomes 0 because on the ground the y coordinate is 0. And the instant at which it hits the ground is called the time of flight. And so we can measure time of flight. So this is the expression for y. So I have h minus half gtf square equals to 0, which gives me time of flight equals to under root 2h by g. And range, again, because the x component of the velocity will remain constant and the x equals to ut. So the range is utf, and utf is given by u times under the square root of the quantity 2h divided by g. So these are the expressions which we have obtained and which are shown here, that in case of the horizontal projectile, this is the initial velocity, this is the acceleration, the initial position is at height h, the equation of trajectory is given here, the time of flight under the square root of 2h of divided by g, and the range, the expressions I have given. So you can use this expression directly also for making numerical calculations if the problems given is the problem of horizontal projectile launched from the height h. Now here, because the angle of projection is 1, I have considered 3 different speeds. If you project with the speed 5 meter per second, 10 meter per second and 20 meter per second, and since I have chosen height equals to 5 meter and 2h will be therefore 10, and g is also nearly 10, so to under root the 2h upon g, the time of flight for most these cases would be equal to nearly 1 second. But what you find that if you project with the speed 5 meter per second, it is hitting at about 5 meter away. If you project with 10 meter per second, it is hitting at about height 10 meter per away and the ground, and if you project with the 20 meters. So depending upon more is the height, the more it will be the horizontal range in case of horizontal projectile with different speeds which I have explained. So horizontal projectile, if you want to increase the range, you have to increase the speed, keeping the height same. If several objects are falling, or if you are projecting from height h, then definitely you can make a conclusion that the object which is falling at higher range was falling and was projected with the higher speed. Or in that way, by measuring the range, you can also determine the projection, horizontal projection speed experimentally. So next, to conclude and complete all the cases, I consider the projectile which is launched at a downward angle. So I call the angle as negative angle or downward. So it would not rise because we are projecting it at a downward angle theta. And so the expressions are given here. We define again the problem in the same manner. But since the velocity is making an angle minus theta, so the expression for initial velocity will become u cos theta I minus u sin theta j. So this is just different here, that in case of upward projection you are having plus sign here. Now you have a minus sign here, and that would be reflected in all the expression. And so when you do the calculation, you find that the velocity is given by u cos theta I plus u sin theta minus gt. So this will be minus u sin theta minus gt. There is a mistake again, I have noticed, as correctly written here, Vy is minus u. So this will be minus u sin theta minus gt. And here also you would have minus ut sin theta minus r gt square. So here I have made a correction, but since I have copied the table, so I forgot to make appropriate correction here. So please make a correction. This is negative and this is also negative. So change the sign. Such typos occur because I use cut and paste for making the PowerPoint presentation. And so these expressions are correct. Definitely y component and x component, and based on this x, y component, you can write the vector because it is very easy. X component times I plus y component times j would give you the expression on this side for the vector expressions. And we can find again that there is a change of sign in case of the trajectory equation here. H minus x tan theta minus half g x square u square cos square theta. This is cos square theta, another typo which has been noticed here. This is cos square theta. And I hope in the previous expression also, please check whether I have written cos theta. It would be cos square theta, because from here you get t equals to x by u cos theta. So when you substitute, you would get cos square theta here. So another typo which need to be corrected. And now the entire expression of time of flight you can obtain by putting this y at t equals to tf equals to 0. It would again give a quadratic equation. There would be two solutions. One with negative sign here has been dropped because that will give you negative value of time of flight, and this is the expression, and we have given the expression of time of flight. The range can be calculated from u cos theta time of flight. So this expression here, again the trajectory equation, the appropriate correction you need to make because it has been copied from there. So cos square theta, replace it by. So I hope here I have correctly shown that use u cos theta I minus u sin theta j. Now the examples have been taken for different angles, pi by 3, pi by 4, pi by 6, and what you are finding that the range is this. So again, what you find that the range of pi by 4 is not maximum when you are projecting something vertically downward at a certain angle theta to downward angle theta from height h. So that particular statement, which is often memorized by student, is valid only when the projectile is projected from the ground. Now, general projectile expressions which we have obtained in the case of projection speed u, projection angle theta, and launch from height h are very useful. And what you can do, that you can remember this general projectile expression, where what I am assuming that the projectile has been launched from height h, it is having the projection speed u, and projection angle which it is making with the horizontal direction is plus theta. Then we have, I have summarized here the relationship. Acceleration is given by minus gj. Velocity is given by u cos theta I plus u sin theta minus gtj. And the position vector is given by ut cos theta I plus h plus ut sin theta minus half gt square whole times j cap vector. Time taken in attaining maximum height is u sin theta upon g. The maximum height is u h plus u square sin square theta upon 2g. Time of flight is given by this expression, u sin theta by g plus u square sin square theta plus 2gh, and range is given by u cos theta tf, and the trajectory is given by this. So if you remember all these expressions, then by making use of the table which I am now showing, you can get the expression for all the 8 cases. 4 cases we have considered in 2 dimensions, and 4 cases we have earlier considered for 1 dimension. For all these 8 cases, we can get the expressions of different quantities like time taken in attaining maximum height, time of flight, etc. So here I have summarized. So this is the general case where I say projection speed is u, projection angle is theta and initial height is h. If you make a projection from ground, this h becomes 0, otherwise so u theta is 0. If you make horizontal projection from height h, then theta becomes 0 and so this becomes u 0 h. And if you make at negative angle, so theta should be negative and sine of minus theta is minus sine theta, cos of theta is cos theta, that substitution care must be taken. Now earlier we have considered in the lecture number 8, so fundamentals of physics 008, the similar cases of projections for one dimension, and those can also be taken. So for vertical upward projection from height h, replace theta by pi by 2. For vertical upward projection from ground, replace theta by pi by 2 and h by 0. For vertical downward projection, theta by minus pi by 2 and height remains h. And for free fall, the initial speed is 0, angle has no sense because there is no projection and the height remains h. So what, by using this values of u, theta and h shown here and these expressions which I am showing, you can get all the expression of 8 different cases of projectile. So if you want to solve numerical calculations, then the one technique is that you remember this particular sheet of expression and you remember this table, and then by remembering this table you can get the suitable expression. But for that also a practice would be required. So with this we conclude our discussion on projectile motion, and in next talk we will take up kinematics in two dimensions. I would continue with some examples of projectile motion and other examples of kinematics in two dimensions, some numerical questions, and later on in the series we will take up uniform circular motion and relative motion. I hope you are liking my lectures. Please click the like button. To subscribe my YouTube channel A4Science, click the subscribe button. To get notification, click the bell icon. Thank you for being with me in this series of lectures.